Hi, welcome to Car Corner. My name is Richard Saxon. I'm the coordinator of the automotive program here at the Community College of Philadelphia. In today's episode, you're going to see Dan Reed discuss the most important part in your car, tires. If you have any questions about our program, please contact us at the website. Thank you, and have a great day.
Hi, I'm Dan Reed, instructor here at the Automotive Technology Program at Community College of Philadelphia. Welcome to Car Corner. Today, we're going to be talking about tires. Now, you probably don't think the tires are all that important or all that interesting, but the fact is, tires are, hands down, the most important part on any motor vehicle. Let me just give you an example. First of all, everything on the car is in contact with the road through just four tires. Now, the tires themselves may have a contact patch about that big, but more importantly, the handling, the acceleration, the stopping, all of that comes down to where the rubber meets the road. And more importantly, your family's safety is literally riding on those tires. So, without a doubt, tires are the most important part on the car. Another example would be is if you took, say, tires off a small car, something not performance oriented, and then you put those tires on maybe a Lamborghini or a Ferrari or a Porsche, and you tried to drive the same way that you would if that vehicle had the tires that it was equipped with from the factory, you would not be able to have that car perform at its maximum potential because of the tires being different. So tires are very, very critical, and their money very well spent, and that's what we're going to talk about today. So the first thing is most people just assume that tires are made out of just black rubber and they kind of wear down and then you have to buy them and they're expensive and it's a pain in the butt to work with them. But tires themselves have gone through massive amounts of evolution. And the tires that are on your car today are probably based off tires that were, well, let's just say that the tires that are on most race cars today are probably going to be, some of that technology is going to find its way into tires about 5 years from now. So tire technology has drastically changed over the past 20 years, in part because of the motorsports industry. If we take a look at a tire, we notice that they're all pretty much black, and that's because a large part of the tire is actually made of oil, petroleum products, as well as coal and rubber and other compounds molded together and blended into a tire and then cast into a shape through a process known as vulcanization. Basically, they start with a powder and they basically put that powder, they roll it out into a long strip, roll it into a donut-sized circle, and then put this in a pressure cooker. And it's that pressure cooker that has this mold that's going to give the tire its shape and tread pattern. So looking at the tire, we see that it's got a brand name there, and that's all fine and good. And that's what most people kind of just assume with the tire. They might go for a brand name just for status, or maybe they're just going for economy. Most people don't understand what the actual numbers on the tire mean, and that's part of what we're going to talk about. So the first number right here, the first number that we see is this designation that starts usually with a letter. It might start with the letter P or LT sometimes, or sometimes there's not even a letter there. And the P stands in this case for passenger car tire, which means that this is a tire made for a passenger car. LT might mean that the tire is made for a light truck or an SUV. And the difference between a P tire and an LT tire, well, a lot of SUVs today get used as passenger cars, but it really comes down to the amount of weight that the tire can actually carry while the vehicle is loaded. Passenger cars are actually not really designed to carry more than 600 pounds usually, and the tire is designed to reflect that, whereas something like a light truck tire, which you might find on an SUV or a pickup truck, is going to be able to handle much more weight. The next number that we have is, on this tire, it reads 225. And what that is that's the width of the tire from shoulder to shoulder in millimeters. Now, here in the United States, we're usually used to things like inches and feet, and tires being a world commodity generally are broken down into metric designations. Although there's one tricky part which doesn't make any sense, and I'll explain that in a little bit. So That's the width of the tire. And that's a fairly, it's an average width tire for a modern sedan. Some tires go up to 350, which you might find on the back of a sports car. And some tires go down to maybe 165, something very narrow on an economy model. Then we have a slash. And then the next number we have is a 50. And the 50 is a percentage number, and that gives us our sidewall height of the tire. The higher the sidewall number, the taller the tire is going to be. The lower the sidewall number, the lower profile it's going to be. And what it is, it's actually a percentage number. That means that the sidewall height of this tire is 50% of the width of the tire. So as tires get wider, their sidewall height is actually going to change. And that number is going to tell the buyer exactly what type of sidewall height you're going to have. Now, sidewall height has an interesting trade-off in both directions. If you start getting a very tall sidewall number, the car is going to really float down the road. I mean, I have a lot of rubber here to act as a cushion over bumps and dips, and that's fine. However, when I corner that car, this sidewall is really going to flex a whole lot, and it might kind of get like a squirmy feel. The other side of that is if I go with a very low profile tire. A low profile tire is really going to perform very well under adverse handling conditions, but the trade-off is it's definitely going to ride much firmer than a higher sidewall tire. So most sedans and average vehicles usually have something around in the 50 or 60% range. A compact sports sedan or a sports car might go as low as 30. I've even seen tires down to 20 at this point. And there are a few tires on the market specially made for aftermarket applications that go as low as 10% on a very wide tire. The next letter that we have after that 50 is an R. Now, a lot of people think the R stands for maybe that it's a racing tire, or maybe even that it's the radius of the wheel, but it's not. It simply stands to show you that this is a radial designed tire. Now, all modern tires today are radial designed, but at one point we used to use a technology known as bias or bias ply tires. And what it basically meant was that the actual tire structure on the inside of the tire was kind of cut at angles, all right? The inside of the tire was actually made out of polyester fiber, or in some very old tires, cotton, nylon, mixed with the rubber. The problem with that was those tires handled horribly. They were not good handling tires, and in fact, most of the cars in the 50s and even into the 60s used bias ply tires. It wasn't until the 1970s when the Michelin Corporation actually invented the steel belted radial tire, and what they did, instead of having those cords on an angle, they actually wrapped them around radially around the center. So they had these bands that really squeezed the tire together, and it actually made the tire much stiffer, much longer lasting, and it actually made the tire roll easier down the road. So fuel economy was just improved by having radial tires. Well, that was such a big advantage in tire technology that, you know, the federal government felt that the general public had to be aware of what type of tires they were running on their vehicle, and automotive manufacturers pretty much caught on quickly to sell a vehicle with radial tires was a selling point. It meant you got better fuel economy, the tires themselves lasted longer, and the car actually handled better because of it. The R is still around because, well, it's just sort of like an appendix. It's always there, and you know, you just want to make sure that you do in fact have a radial-based tire. The last number that we're going to see here is the diameter of the wheel, which is the actual opening of the wheel. And this is where it gets a little tricky. It's in inches, it's not in millimeters. Now, why they went with inches here and millimeters for the width, I don't exactly know. In fact, nobody has ever given me a right answer. But it's important to remember not to get too confused about the fact that the overall wheel diameter is inches versus millimeters, which is the tread width. Okay. When people generally talk about putting larger wheels and tires on a vehicle, they're generally talking about the diameter, increasing the diameter of the wheel. You got to realize, though, that when you do that, eventually you're going to basically enlarge the tire to the point where it might actually contact the body or suspension components, and that's going to lead to some problems. So going to a larger tire than what's stock can sometimes be a little problematic, and it may actually lead to some changes in the vehicle. All right? So there's some other additional numbers which are on the tire that may only be printed on one side of the tire. So if you go looking for the numbers and you can't find them, they may be on the inside or the outside of the tire, and you may have to actually take the tire off the vehicle and try to find this. But we're going to see that we have our P225-50R17, which we've already talked about. And then we have another number that says 93V. Now what the 93 correlates to is a chart, which is a load range for the tire, which basically says how much weight each individual tire can carry. Now the chart is fairly complicated, and you can find it pretty easily on the internet if you're curious. But if you're going to be carrying very, very heavy loads with a car, that's the number that you want to have be bigger. Okay, the bigger that number, the more weight it can carry. The next letter is V. V correlates to the overall top speed of the tire, of what is appropriate for the tire. Now, while the speed limit is generally 55, 65 miles an hour in North America, you have to realize there's other parts of the world where maybe they don't have a speed limit. And the fact is temperature is one of the things that's going to cause the tire to overheat and disintegrate as you're going down the road. As the tire's rolling, it's always flexing, it's squirming, it's absorbing bumps, and it builds up a whole lot of heat. The number that's going to give us the speed rating of the tire, again, is going to correlate to a chart. And for the longest time, Z or ZR tires were rated as the highest. And I think Z tires were 149 miles an hour and up. And then we went to ZR tires, which were even faster than that. So that's another thing that's going to come into a big cost of the tire, is how much speed the tire can take. I don't know exactly what V is off the top of my head, but again, it correlates to a chart. And unfortunately, whoever designed the chart wasn't thinking very straight, because the letters kind of jump around based on how fast the vehicle can actually travel. So you want to make sure you refer to the chart. The next thing we can see here is M plus S. And M plus S tells us that this is an all-season tire. And what that means is that the tire is made for mud and snow, generally wintertime. Okay? Now, some tires are designed to be summer-only performance tires, and that's great. Those tires are designed for hot, sticky traction in hot weather or lots of rain in the summertime. However, in the wintertime, when it gets colder out, the rubber compound on the tire actually becomes hard and the tires don't perform well at all. And at that point, you would have to switch over to either all-season tires or winter tires. What we generally do here in North America is we'll just put on one set of tires and roll with them all year. And there's nothing wrong with that. However, again, there's some trade-offs. Those summer tires are going to handle much better in the summertime, and winter tires are going to give you much better traction in the winter. And I don't necessarily mean old-fashioned studded snow tires. You can get a very performance-oriented snow winter tire. But generally, most people are going to go for all-season tires, so you want to make sure that you have an M and S logo on your tires if that's what you're going for. The next thing we have is DOT, and that stands for Department of Transportation. Now, each tire has to be certified in North America by the Department of Transportation to be sold here in the United States. They basically want to make sure that we're not getting some cheap inferior tires that are going to become dangerous to the people that buy them. We got two series of numbers, and what these are is these are basically a special code or serial number for the tire that's going to basically go back and explain again on a chart who the manufacturer was, what plant the factory was made at, where the tire was made, what country, what state, that type of thing. And then what these last four numbers are is they are a date code, which is the birthday of the tire. Now, it can be a little tricky to try to figure this out on your own, but once you understand what the code is, it actually makes a lot of sense. This tire was made on the 46th week of 2007, okay? So right there, you have a pretty good idea of when this tire was actually manufactured. And it's important, if you're going to buy a set of tires and they seem to be some kind of great deal, make sure you're not buying tires that have been sitting in a warehouse for 5 years and they're going on your car. You want relatively fresh tires. Generally, you know, average driver is going to probably have tires on the vehicle for at least 2, 3, maybe sometimes 4 years. And then after that point, the tires are going to be worn down. But you always want to make sure to look at the birthday of the tire. And if you happen to see 3 digits here, that means the tire was actually manufactured before the year 2000, in which case that tire is trash. Okay? So there's actually a few more interesting things that we can see here about our tire. Right here, it tells us the maximum safe inflation pressure of this tire, which is, looks to be about 44 PSI. And they're saying that this tire can handle a maximum load range of 650 kilograms, or about 14,000 pounds, 1,400 pounds. So what a lot of people make as a mistake is they see this maximum inflation pressure, and that's what they inflate the tires to, and that's wrong, okay? That inflation pressure should only be inflated to that point, either for performance reasons or if you're planning to really load the vehicle down. And yes, if you're wondering, should I inflate my tires if I'm going on a long family road trip? I'm going to have 4 people in the car. I'm going to have some luggage. Should I inflate my tires for that weight? And the answer is yes, you are actually supposed to do that. I would hope, of course, that you check your tire pressure before you went on that family trip anyway. But you want to make sure to refer to the chart on the vehicle and not the warning on the tire for exactly how much to inflate that tire to. All right, so let's see, we have another piece of information on our tire. And right here, we have 3 statements. We have a tread wear number, we have a traction number, and we have a temperature number. Now these, again, were federally mandated by the US government, and this is known as the Uniform Tire Quality Grading Label. This was designed to help kind of just inform the consumer of what kind of tire they were buying. Generally speaking, the tread wear number is going to tell you exactly how long the tire is going to last. So a tread wear of 100 is the base number for tires, and anything above that means the tire will last longer. Generally speaking, a 200 tire will last twice as long as a 100 tire, okay? Some performance tires, because of that soft, sticky compound, may be very low numbers, which means you may only get a summer's worth of driving out of those tires if you're really going to push them hard. Whereas, again, an all-season tire, it's designed to last a little while, and anything above 300, maybe 400, is going to be a long-lasting tire. Some tires, which may be very expensive, may actually go into the almost 100,000 mile range. If you're going to do a whole lot of highway driving, the tire's actually made out of a much harder compound, and the tire's going to last a very, very long time. The next number is traction. Now, generally, when people think of traction with the tire, they're thinking about maybe, you know, accelerating from a stoplight. But the fact is the traction label only applies to the wet handling traction ability of the tire. So if you want a tire that's going to handle well in the wet weather, you want an A or a double A rating. A tire that might be a B or C traction tire may be great for dry weather, but the fact is, as soon as it starts to rain, it's not going to perform well at all, and you might slide or skid. The last statement is the temperature, and it goes A, B, or C. Temperature A means that this tire is going to be able to get really hot, and it's not going to fall apart. Temperature ratings of B or C, well, they're not going to last as long. They can't handle as much heat. A temperature rated tires become important in areas of the country where it is very hot, maybe down in Arizona or Texas, where if you're going to be doing a lot of sustained high-speed highway driving, you're going to want a good quality temperature rated tire. And generally, overall, if you had a tire with these ratings, that would be a good, safe tire to buy. Well, along with it being a mud and snow rated tire, would say that, hey, this would be a great tire for, you know, just about anybody to have if they just wanted to have one set of tires on their car and not worry about it too much. Okay, we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to take a look at some of the repair procedures for inside a tire.
Somebody. shifted a little bit.
This way?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's pretty close to the way you had it before.
Yeah, I'm just talking about this. So, let's take a look at some other types of tires. This is being an all-season tire, but let's take a look at some of the other choices that we might have when you're shopping for tires. All right. This is a performance tire. Now, you may notice that it's got a little more of a square, chunky look to it. But the big difference is that you notice that the tread pattern here is sort of pointing in one direction. And that actually is what's known as a directional tire. And that means this tire is designed to only rotate in one direction on the vehicle. If I were to put this tire backwards on the car by actually flipping it around, say this way, as the tire rolled down the road, it would actually scoop water into these channels and cause the tire to float or hydroplane on the surface, and that's very bad. What we want this tire to do instead is, as it rolls down the road, we actually want the water to be channeled and funneled out through these side slits or gutters and actually push the water out of the way so the rubber comes in contact with the road. If you've ever wondered why maybe drag racing cars or cars on a racing circuit have very smooth tires, it's because they want the maximum amount of traction. Most of those vehicles don't race in the rain because the fact is because they have that smooth pattern, there's no place for the water to go but actually under the tire and pick the tire up and the car will skid or slide. So this would be our directional performance tire, and you're going to know that you have one of those because it's going to have marking on it indicating that the tire is going to rotate in a specific direction once it's mounted. Now, tires that are directional do have one minor drawback, and that is when it comes time to rotate the tires on the vehicle, and you might be thinking to yourself, why do I have to rotate the tires? They are rotating as they go down the road. But what that usually means is that if the tire just stays on the back corner of the car, it might develop an odd wear pattern. Rotating the tires every 5,000 miles or 6,000 miles or so generally means I'm going to take this tire, move it from the back of the car, and put it to the front of the car. That's going to allow that wear pattern maybe to even out, and I'll get longer life out of all four tires. However, with the directional tire, since it's rotating in one direction, this tire may only go on one side of the car. So I'm pretty much stuck rotating this from the front to the back. I can't rotate this from the side to side of the car, from the left side to the right side. If I rotate it to the other side of the car, the wheel will fit, but now the tire will be spun around and I'm going to develop a water issue with the tire. And that's actually a very dangerous situation. So you want to make sure that you pay attention to that when you're rotating or buying tires if they are directional. The other thing about some sport wheels and tires is that if this is a directional tire and I have a vehicle that has different sized width wheels, and for an example, if you look at the back of maybe a Porsche or a BMW or a Mercedes-Benz, the back wheels are actually a little wider than the front. Those vehicles being rear drive want that traction. They want that wide, meaty tire on the back to give them all the push it can. And if those tires are directional with rotation, that means that I can't put that wide tire in the back on the front wheel of that car. Literally, those cars' alignments have to be perfect. And one of our instructors here has a vehicle with that setup, and it gets very expensive because when you wear down one tire, you can't just rotate it somewhere else on the vehicle. You actually have to replace the tire at that point. So it can get very expensive. All right, let's take a look at another type of tire. And this is affectionately referred to as the donut. The proper term is Space Saver Spare Tire. Now, we went to Space Saver Spare Tires in the 80s because they are smaller. Because they are smaller, they weigh less, and because they weigh less, cars got better fuel economy. So it was just a bonus for the industry. A couple important things about this, though, is that this tire has the letter T in front of it. And that means that it is a temporary spare tire, and it is designed only for short distances. Generally speaking, most of these are limited to a top speed of 50 miles an hour, and they're good for 50 miles, which means you can't go very far and you can't go very fast on this tire. I have seen people drive for weeks and weeks on these tires, and it is a bad idea. This is a temporary tire, okay? It's not a spare tire in the sense that it's a full-size spare and you can drive around town on it all day. I really don't like temporary spare tires. They're good in an emergency, but the problem is since this lives in the trunk of your vehicle, it generally goes flat. Because when people check the tire pressure, they forget to check the spare tire pressure. So it's important to remember to make sure that you inflate this properly. And the other thing is, while your other tires may be around 30 to 32 PSI, this tire does get inflated to its maximum pressure, which right here is 60. Now that's a whole lot of pressure for this little tire. And the reason why it needs that pressure is because this little tire, it's sort of like a bicycle tire. It's got to support a lot of weight in a small surface area. And the way they do that is with the pressure. All right, so just remember not to drive on a temporary spare. All right, let's take a look at tire injuries. Guys doing all right? So here we have a tire that has had a hard life. It has lots of wear on either side of the tire. Now, what causes wear on the sides of the tire like this, if it's uniform left and right, means that the tire was run on very low air pressure for an extended period of time. Running a tire on low air pressure is extremely dangerous because, first of all, the tire is going to wear out faster. Second of all, the tire itself is actually going to heat up, and that's going to cause the tire to break down. But the most dangerous part of running a tire low on air pressure is that it handles very, very poorly. You will actually pretty much lose control over an underinflated tire fairly easily if it's very low on pressure. The trick is, and the hard thing about radial tires is, you can't just look at them and tell the air pressure. You actually have to measure the air pressure, and I'll show you how to do that in a little bit. But this tire actually wore out so badly that we started to expose some of the internal structures and cords of the tire. Now, when a tire gets this low, it is beyond its safe limit. And this sharp piece of steel sticking out here is actually part of those steel belts. And I'll just warn you, these are extremely sharp. If you happen to run your hand across the tire, I've seen some people really get hurt. These things are like needles. They're very, very sharp. So please be careful when you're handling a tire that has exposed cords. The other thing is, with this tire, it has what's known as a wear bar. Now, this is generally found on most tires, and it's a small bar pattern that goes across the face of the tire. What the wear bar is when that wear bar gets exposed anywhere with the surface of the tire, it's considered pretty much done. That means the tire has 2/32 of an inch of tread left. Now, the state of Pennsylvania says that the minimum thickness of a tire has to be 2/32. However, most industry experts, as well as tire manufacturers and automotive manufacturers, will tell you that 4/32 is really the best bet. All right. So this tire has definitely seen better days. Two other types of injuries, let's take a look at those. So let's take a look at two of the most common ways to actually repair a tire if the tire itself gets damaged. First of all, if the tire has any kind of damage right here in the sidewall area of the tire's done. There's nothing you can do for a gash in the sidewall of the tire. So basically the rule is anywhere that you're gonna see numbers, lettering, and maybe even up to the shoulder of the tire right about here, it's done. That's the end of it. You can't fix it. You can't put any kind of tape or glue or anything back on the tire. And that's because the sidewall of the tire is actually a very weak part of the tire. However, if we get a puncture anywhere in the meaty part of the tread of the tire can generally be repaired safely and reliably for the rest of the life of the tire. The two most basic types of ways to fix a tire once it's been damaged is either plugging or patching. Now, patching a tire is really the approved method because you actually have to take the tire off the wheel. We call that demounting the tire from the wheel. And you can actually inspect the damage area on the inside of the tire and really give a good idea as to whether or not the tire is actually salvageable. So the way that you go through a process of patching a tire is we generally have two different types of tire patches. Now these little patches are set up in such a way that they have an adhesive on them, and it works with a chemical reaction with a bonding glue, an all-purpose cement that's actually very much like rubber cement. And the process to put these on is fairly easy. You're going to first locate the damaged area of the tire, and then after you remove the foreign object, a screw, a nail, whatever it may be, you're going to use something called a buffing wheel. And what this is a high-speed buffer with an abrasive end to it, and we're going to actually rough up the inside of the tire. We're going to make it kind of have a little bit of a tooth pattern or a keyed pattern to it. And what that's going to do is that's going to give our glue a place to sit and a place for me to put my patch on top. After I go through and buff the area, what I'm going to do is I'm then going to add the glue and the patch and put that on the inside here. And I'm then going to use something called a stitching wheel. And the stitching wheel is going to actually make sure that that patch bonds properly with the actual tire itself, using that glue as an adhesive to kind of almost weld those two pieces together. At that point, the tire is going to be airtight and can be mounted back on the wheel and rebalanced and put back into service. And the nice thing about patches is that they don't do anything to the cords inside the tire. Now, we might break a couple cords, and at that point, generally, once you repair a tire, the speed rating of the tire is no longer valid. So they just say, you know, most industry experts just say, well, if the tire was rated for 149 miles an hour, obviously don't drive that fast anymore with a damaged or repaired tire. The other type of repair is actually much simpler and much faster to do, and that is known as a plug. Now, the plug on the end of the tire, I'll spin it around here, the plug on the end of the tire, this one's actually partially visible through the outside. What these kind of look like is they sort of look like a sticky gummy caterpillar almost, sort of like a nasty piece of chewing gum. And these are made out of a sticky, boy, I don't know what they're made of, but they're pretty nasty looking, and they feel it too. But they're really, really strong. The insides of these are actually like bonded nylon. And what we can actually do with this is we'll actually ream out the hole using something called a reamer. Now, the reamer is a sharp tool that has a raspy file on it. After I go through and I remove the foreign object from inside the tire, I'm then going to ram this back in through the hole of the tire and actually enlarge the hole. Now, this is where the dispute comes into play, because when I go through and I ram this through the inside, from the outside of the tire, what I'm actually doing is I'm separating and possibly damaging more of that cord structure inside the tire. Once that's done, I'm then going to actually feed this through something that looks like a large sewing needle. Now, this end on here is split, and I'm going to pass this through and pull it. I would then apply some of my glue to this plug, and then I would actually insert it down through the tire. Now, this is actually quite difficult to do. It's pretty strenuous work. And when I'm all done, I'm going to end up with the plug sticking through the outer surface of the tire. I'll usually cut this off with a razor blade or a pair of wire cutters. And then on the inside of the tire, I'm going to actually have part of the plug. Now, for a long time, tire plugs were accepted very easily as a way to repair a tire quickly. They're inexpensive. You do not have to demount the tire from the rim. And in fact, I've just done them on the car. I've never even taking the wheels off the car. Sometimes I can just plug them and go. And they will hold air, but the problem is now I have this foreign object permanently lodged inside the body of the tire, and there is a chance that at high speeds, This could further weaken and possibly have the tire disintegrate or blow out. So most of the professional industry really prefers patching over plugging, but you can still buy plug kits. And plugs, in my book, if you're careful with them, I think they're still going to work okay. But if you're the slightest bit worried, or your industry professional says, we don't plug tires, we patch them, just go along with that and let them do their job. So, we talked about the rubber part that goes around the outside of the wheel, and that's called the tire, and this is called the wheel, also sometimes affectionately referred to as a rim, although most of the industry refers to this as the actual wheel assembly itself. So our wheel, in this case, is an alloy model, okay? Sometimes referred to as a mag wheel, and the reason why they were called mag wheels is because back in the 50s and the 40s and the 30s, when racing was first getting started by industry, they actually made wheels out of magnesium. Very lightweight, relatively strong metal. However, magnesium has some real problems associated with it. It corrodes very easily, and it's actually a flammable metal. However, it's extremely lightweight. And the name just kind of stuck. Any kind of wheel that is a metallic wheel just got referred to as a mag wheel. Again, it's short for magnesium. The wheels themselves, the mag wheels, are going to be actually painted generally with a silver finish and then finished with a clear coat that's very similar to the actual body of the vehicle. So we'll cover cleaning tires and wheels in a few minutes here. The tire and wheel itself are designed to work together. So if you're going to change the wheels on the vehicle, you're going to have to probably change the tires as well if you're changing sizes. We've gone over the tire sizes. Wheels have their own language for sizes as well. If we flip this around, we can see a couple things here. We can see that right here, we can see the manufacturer of this wheel. This is a wheel from a Honda. It says Honda Manufacturing Corporation. Okay, so right there we know who made this wheel. What kind of car is it off of? Sometimes there are aftermarket manufacturers that will make wheels. Sometimes they actually make wheels for a specific manufacturer. And sometimes it's good to know where exactly your wheels came from, that they came from a good quality brand. The next number that we have on here is we have the size of the wheel. And this number right here is a 17 by 7.5 J55. Now, to me as a car guy, that tells me everything I need to know about this wheel. What that means is that this wheel is a 17-inch wheel. So it's designed to fit a 17-inch tire. So the actual diameter of the wheel from lip to lip is 17, okay? The next number, 7.5, is telling me the width of the tire, and that's the width of the tire in inches. And it's generally from the center area to the center area of the wheel is going to tell me the overall width of the wheel. If you're going to go with a performance vehicle, you might actually want a wider wheel, and that's fine. However, you don't want the wheel to stick outside of the body of the car, and you don't want it to look like it's sucked into the body of the car either. And that leads us to our last number that is really important, and that is 55, okay? The 55 down here is going to tell us that that is what's known as the wheel's offset or backspacing. And that number is actually in millimeters. See, this is where it's going to actually attach to the hub of the vehicle. And by controlling the depth or backspacing here this way is going to dictate where the center line of this vehicle actually rides in relation to the body or the wheel axis of the car. Sometimes if I have an offset of zero, that means that the wheel is going to mount here. A 55 is going to be a little more this way, and if I have something such as a negative offset, it means that the wheel is going to be mounted back here. What that's going to mean is that's going to control how much the wheel sticks in or out of the vehicle. Okay? The other thing that we have is that we'll have the actual bolt pattern. And the bolt pattern itself of the wheel is going to dictate exactly what type of wheel, what type of vehicle it will mount to. Now, they do make aftermarket adapters. However, depending on where you get your car inspected and what state, they may or may not be legal. Generally, we're going to measure, you know, the number of lug nuts or wheel bolts that we have going through the wheel. This would be 5, obviously. Sometimes we may have a truck that has 6 or 8. Some cars have 4, and some cars actually have 3. Okay? And then the spacing in between these is going to dictate the actual size. So this might be a 5 by 114, which is going to say that it's 114 millimeters between 2 stud locations on the wheel. And those are big factors that you have to pay attention to when you're going to select a wheel or tire for your vehicle, is will those wheels fit my car and will they look good on the car? Will they stick out too much? Will they be too wide and rub against components? So there's a lot of thought involved in actually setting up a wheel and tire package for your vehicle if you're moving away from stock. Okay, so the wheel itself, what we're going to have is we're going to have some type of a way to get the air in and out of the tire. Now, this tire has something known as a TPMS sensor. And what a TPMS sensor is a TPMS sensor is a small radio transmitter that's going to be located inside the tire. What this does is it will communicate with the onboard computer of the car and alert the driver of what the tire pressure is inside the vehicle. Now, some performance vehicles will actually show you a number on the dash, like a Chevy Corvette will actually be able to tell you what the tire pressure is in each individual tire. However, most vehicles just have a generic icon on the dashboard that will come on and tell you that a tire is low. And some vehicles will even have an aftermarket setup, and that icon right there is the symbol for your tire pressure is low. When that light comes on, it means that whatever the manufacturer has dictated as tire pressure, you are 25% below that minimum recommended pressure, so it's definitely time for you to check your tires. The reason why we went to TPMS was because people were getting involved with bad accidents because tires were running low on air pressure. Specifically, some larger SUVs and some mid-sized SUVs had some issues about 10 or 15 years ago where the tires would fail due to low tire pressure and then roll over and occupants would be hurt. So TPMS is really a kind of a more modern way to do that. Some manufacturers are able to monitor tire pressure based on wheel rotation, and that's a different type of system. The most standard common type of valve stem, though, is something that looks like this. Okay, this would normally fit inside the wheel in place of the TPMS sensor, and this is how we get the air in and out of the tire. And the valve stem is this whole piece. The cap here threads on the end, and about the caps, it's very important that you install and use a valve cap. If you don't, this is actually one of the primary seals that keeps the air inside the tire. If you have a tire that keeps going flat and you don't have a cap on it, chances are the air is leaving out through the stem. So just make sure you have a cap. One important note, if you happen to see that the valve cap is green instead of black, that means that the tire has been filled with pure nitrogen gas rather than our atmospheric mixture of oxygen and nitrogen. Nitrogen inflation has a couple great benefits to it for the cost. It does cost a little more. There are only a few stations that can do it, and they will charge you for that service. However, nitrogen inflated into a tire will not leak out as fast as atmospheric air, and also it tends to run cooler, so the tire actually lasts a little longer. So there are some performance benefits to having a tire inflated with nitrogen. The color green on the cap, well, it means that it's inflated with nitrogen, and the way I like to think of it is green is the color of money, and that means they spent money to put nitrogen in their tires, and that maybe, just maybe, before you do any work on the wheel or tire assembly, if you're a professional, you want to at least make them aware that maybe you can or cannot refill the vehicle with nitrogen. If you do have a vehicle filled with nitrogen and you do find it's low in air pressure, do not hesitate to put regular oxygen, you know, atmospheric compounds back into the tire, because that is safer than running the tire low in air pressure, and then your service station will be able to evacuate the tire and refill it with nitrogen again. Okay? All right. Let's take a look at a few other pieces of our wheel and tire, namely the lug nuts. The part that actually attaches the wheel to the hub of the vehicle are the lug nuts or wheel studs. Now, depending on who manufactured the vehicle, depends on kind of their theory behind how they actually attach the wheel to the car. First of all, some manufacturers actually use a decorative protective cap on the outside of a lug nut. Now, what this does is it just strictly gives the appearance of maybe a little slicker look on the outside of the car. But it's important to realize that most of these don't come off in any seriously complicated way. There's actually a little hook you put in through here and then pop it off, and then there's your work surface right there on the lug nut. Most European manufacturers actually use wheel bolts, and this is a wheel bolt. And they come in various lengths and sizes, and depending on the application, that's what the car takes. Now, why European cars use wheel bolts and domestic cars and Asian vehicles generally don't, I don't know. Again, I've never been able to find a great example as to why this is somehow superior to lug nuts, but it's just the accepted method. Lug nuts come in two basic types of flavors. You can have a decorative chrome, or you can have just a industrial bolt. These are actually off the same vehicle, and I don't think I have to explain which one cost a few dollars more. If you have a car that has a an alloy wheel, you might have the chrome ones. If you have a car with hubcaps, you might just have the regular steel nuts. One important thing, though, is to make sure that the threads are clean and straight once you take the lug nuts off. If there's any type of galling or damage to the surface of the threads, you're going to actually want to replace that lug nut because it will damage the threads on the hub. And some lug nuts actually have a washer on them. Okay, now this washer is used on certain types of performance vehicles and different types of wheels, but what's really, really important, and I've seen a lot of people do this, is they will mix these up. They'll just kind of miss one of these and they'll throw one of these in its place, assuming that the thread is the same. And the fact is, this will not hold this type of wheel safely to a car. This will actually back off and the wheel will fall off. The other thing is that if you notice, the bases of these are not the same. One has a very large base, one has a very small cone-shaped base, and that's going to affect how well the tire's held to the hub. Some vehicles, like this one right here, will have what's known as an acorn base or a ball seat base versus this base, which is a little more straight or a cone shape. So again, the actual lug nut itself is going to be an important factor when you change your wheels. If you are changing your wheels and tires on your vehicle, you're going to want to make sure that your lug nuts either match or you have the correct lug nuts for your new wheel. Okay, let's take a look at how to clean and maintain the appearance of a wheel. We're down here at our wheel and tire assembly on the vehicle, and the first thing I'm going to cover is how to check and set tire pressure. Now, tire pressure, again, is really, really critical to the safety and performance of the vehicle, and the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to locate exactly where the tire pressure is on this vehicle, and right here on this car, it's right behind the fuel door. Now, the decal here says that the rear is supposed to be set for 32 as well as the front for 32. Depending on the amount of passengers and weight that you're going to carry in the vehicle. So I know that I'm going to have 32. Generally, it's just me and the vehicle commuting. So I'm going to remove the valve stem cap down here, and I'm going to take my tire pressure gauge. Now you can buy one of the radial style gauges or even a digital one, but I find that the pen style, the old fashioned style, works just fine. I'm going to look at the PSI scale, and I'm going to take my tire pressure reading. Get a nice positive seal on there, and I can see that I have a little more than, looks like it was about 34 PSI, so that's pretty good. One of the important things is that when you check and set tire pressures, to make sure that the tires and wheels are cool. Most manufacturers will tell you to check and set the tire pressure only when the tire pressure is what they consider cold. What is cold? Well, some people say it's when you first start out driving in the morning. Some people say it's after at least an hour of having the vehicle sit. But the fact is these wheels definitely are nice and cool. My pressure is a little bit high, which is not uncommon, and that's where the pen style comes in handy. It's got a little button here on the end, and what I can do is I can use this end to actually release some of the pressure in the tire. Then I'll check it again. And check it one more time. There we go, good positive seal that time. And right now I'm at exactly 32 PSI. So this tire is exactly where it needs to be. If I had to add air to it rather than remove air out, I would just need an air line and a tire chuck, and I could put the air inside the vehicle. Now, if you remember back to when I talked about those nitrogen-filled tires, they actually have an air compressor system that actually compresses nitrogen versus just atmospheric oxygen and nitrogen. All right, so tire pressure is all set for this. We're good to go. I'm going to actually clean this wheel. And you might say, why bother cleaning the wheels on the vehicle? Well, these are some nice-looking aftermarket wheels I have, and I want to keep them clean because they were expensive. And if I leave this brake dust, which is what this dirt is, on the wheel, as the wheel gets wet and it heats and cools, this brake dust will continue to build up, and it's going to actually start to etch into the clear coat of the wheel. Once it starts to etch into the clear coat of the wheel, it's going to actually work its way down to the metal surface and cause corrosion. By removing it now, before it gets to be big, heavy buildup, I don't have to use super harsh chemicals to actually clean the wheel. And since I am going to clean the wheel, I'm basically going to do a process where I'm going to wash the wheel like I would just wash a car. And that means I'm going to take a nice clean bucket, and I just have a car washing sponge, and I have just proper car wash. If I needed to use something a little more, a little more intense of a cleaner, I would use a specific cleaner made specifically for cleaning wheels. Now, there's a lot of wheel cleaners on the market, and you have to be careful because some wheels are truly a chrome finish, which is a hard metallic finish, and other wheels like this one are actually painted with the clear coat. And if you use the wrong type of wheel cleaner or something too abrasive, you'll actually damage the wheel surface in the process of you trying to clean it and make things look a lot worse. This brand works fine, and you read the directions on the back, and sure enough, it says to start with a cool wheel, spray it with some water, and we'll get started. Slide my bucket out of the way. Spray my wheel down. Wheel cleaner. And I have to wait a couple seconds and let this sit to do its work. I like to use a sponge rather than a scrub brush because, again, it might damage and affect the clear coat of the wheel by scratching it. So I'll just let it sit for a couple seconds. All right. Now, if I need to hit this again,
which I don't think I do. I think it's pretty clean. You know, it's fine to do that. Just again, make sure the wheel is cool when you do this process, because if not, you're going to actually run the risk of possibly cooking your cleaning solvent onto the wheel's finish, and you don't want to do that. When you're all done, I like to take a dry microfiber towel, and a detailing trick is to actually tear off this little tag, because it might actually scratch the wheel surface, and just dry the wheel off. Once the wheel is dry, you may actually want to apply a light finish of spray wax on top of the wheel, and this will help protect the wheel's finish and also help repel some brake dust. It's an optional step. I don't usually do it. However, one of the things which you probably have seen is that nice, slick, shiny look that you see on the sidewalls of the tires, and this product works really well. What's neat about it is it has a nozzle that allows you to adjust the width of the spray of how much actually comes out of the top of the can, and that way you can control exactly how much overspray you have. You probably don't want to spray this on the body of the car or the wheel, because it will actually attract brake dust, and we'll just spray it on here and see how it looks. There we go. That's pretty nice looking. All right. In the next show.
That's all we have time for today.
Okay. That's all the time we have for today. In the future, we're going to look at how wheels and tires are actually mounted and demounted using modern tire changing equipment, as well as balancing them. I'm Dan Reed. Thanks for watching Car Corner. Drive safely. Spray it with some water, and we'll get started. And I got nothing coming out of my hose, because it looks like the hose has blown apart in the back room there, and it's spraying water all over the place. There we go. Yeah. I'm like, what is that noise? Oh, it's the hose. It's blown apart and it's spraying water all over the ground. Okay, there we go. Yay!